Hachette Audio presents The Forgotten Girls, written by Sara Blaedel, translated by Sina Rod Golly, read by Christine Lakin. My own dear mother, I long for you. If only you knew how they mistreat me, confined to bed, bound by belt and gloves, dear mother. I long for you. Solabaz Bow by Solabaz Ruth Christensen. Prologue. Gone is coming. Gone is coming. The words pounded in her ears as the rocks and branches of the forest floor tore her feet and shins. Her head was whirling, and fear made her heart constrict. She was headed for the only light she could see. Like an opening in the dark, the gleam of white pulled her deeper into the woods. Confused and scared, she stumbled through the trees, gasping for air. Her fear of the dark was like a chokehold around her neck. It had been that way ever since she was ordered as a young child to turn off the light and go to sleep. Gone would come and take her. Gone. 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 The words sounded rhythmically, and she was too slow to prevent a branch from flicking across her cheek. Holding her breath, she stopped and stood as if frozen, completely surrounded by the saturated darkness from the trees that towered around her. Her legs were shaking from exhaustion. Frightened by the sound of her own crying, she slowly stepped forward, her eyes fixed on the light ahead. It blinded her when she looked straight at it. She didn't know how she had gotten lost. The door had been ajar, and they hadn't noticed her standing in the doorway. She had been overcome with joy when she felt the sun warming her and beckoning her, but that was hours ago. And now everything had turned cold and unsettling. At one point, hunger made her give up, and she sat down. Twilight fell, while confusing fragments of images tumbled through her head until finally, unable to settle down, not knowing how long she had been sitting, she got back up. She wasn't used to interrupted routines, and being alone was not good, especially not for the person left behind. She increased her speed, getting closer to the white light. It was pulling her in like an irresistible force, and she shut out the pain and the sounds, a skill she had mastered by now. She had never learned to handle the fear, however. She needed to escape the dark, or Gone would come and take her. She was getting close, only a little farther ahead through the last trees. Her heart slowed as she caught a glimpse of a moonlit lake. Just as she was about to slow down, the ground suddenly disappeared from under her feet. Chapter 1. 4 days. That was how much time had passed since the woman's body had been discovered in the woods, and the police had yet to identify her. They didn't have the slightest clue to go on, and Louise Rick was frustrated as she pulled in and parked by the Department of Forensic Medicine late Monday morning. The autopsy had started at 10 a.m., and it had been a bit later when the head of the search department, Ragnar Reinholdt, walked into the office and asked her to drive over and assist her colleague, Ike Nordstrom. Shortly before, forensic medicine had announced the decision to upgrade the autopsy to include homicide tests for DNA. It was Louise's second week as technical manager of the Special Search Agency, a newly established unit of the department. Each year, 1,600 to 1,700 people were reported missing in Denmark. Many turned up again, and some were found dead. But according to the assessment of the National Police, there was a crime behind 1 out of 5 of the unsolved missing person reports. Her department was tasked with investigating these cases. Louise got out and locked the car. She didn't quite understand why they needed her at the autopsy when Ike Nordstrom was already there. He had been off on vacation the past 4 weeks, so he was the only person in the department that she hadn't yet met. It was Louise who had gone through the list of missing persons on Friday afternoon and discovered that none of the missing women matched the description of the woman found in the woods. Perhaps Reinhold felt that she ought to be present for the examination of the deceased as well. Or it could simply be because she had come from the homicide department and had more experience dealing with autopsies than her new colleagues. The move was an unusual step down, to be sure, driven by an excruciating decision Louise had felt compelled to reach. She'd make the best of it, but she wasn't thrilled to be here. It actually felt nice to be tasked with something she knew how to navigate after a week of unfamiliar territory. Louise hadn't foreseen the hopeless feeling when starting a new job of forgetting people's names and not knowing where to find the copier. She had spent the first week organizing the rat hole. Heck of a name, she thought, hoping that it wouldn't stick. She was already growing a bit weary of her colleagues' witty comments about the unused rooms at the end of the hall. The two-person office was above the kitchen and had been empty since pest control had dealt with a considerable rat infestation last spring. But the rats were gone now, and no one had seen them since, her new boss assured her. Ragnar Reinhold had done his part to get the new department in order, purchasing new office chairs and bulletin boards along with a number of plants. The chief superintendent had a personal preference for orchids and apparently felt that some greenery was what was needed to bring life into the unused office. That was all very well, Louise thought. But what really mattered to her was the fact that she sensed his commitment. Ragnar Reinhold was clearly determined to get this new subunit up and running. They had been granted 1 year to prove that there was a need for the special unit, and Louise had everything to gain. If this new job did not become permanent, she risked ending up a local detective somewhere in the district.
"You decide who you want on the team,"
Reinhold had generously told her when he introduced her to the idea of heading the special search agency. Since then, she had considered at length who might be suitable prospects, and the final candidates on her list were all people with whom she had worked before, experienced and competent. First on the list was Saran Valine from the Mobile Task Force. He was used to working all over the country and had good contacts at many local police stations. But he liked his current position, so Louise didn't know how easily he would transfer. The question also remained whether Reinhold would match his current salary. Then there was Sire Gilling from the fraud department. He was great at thinking outside the box. But he was an albino, sensitive to bright daylight, and she was not sure that she could stand always working behind closed curtains. Finally, there was Lars Jarnsen, her most recent partner in the homicide department. They knew each other inside and out, and she felt comfortable working with him. There was also no question that this type of work would suit his temperament, as well as his status as a single dad to two boys from Bolivia. So there were several promising candidates. Louise just hadn't decided yet which one she should try to reel in first. Outside the door to the autopsy unit, she spotted Osir from the Center of Forensic Services. The slender woman was crouched next to her briefcase, but stood up, smiling, as Louise approached.
"We snapped a couple of photos for you before we really got started," she told Louise after they said hello. "Just of the face, in case you decide to ask the public for help in identifying her."
"Yes, it looks like that might become necessary," Louise conceded, even though pictures like that always caused a stir. Some people felt showing the faces of the deceased was too morbid. The forensic officer gestured toward the autopsy rooms, her green eyes serious.
"The woman in there won't be hard to recognize. That is, if she has any next of kin," she said. "The entire right side of her face is covered by a big scar, presumably from a burn wound, which continues down onto her shoulder. So if she hasn't already been reported missing, a picture is probably your best chance of discovering her identity."
Louise nodded, but didn't have a chance to answer because just then, Fleming Larson walked up along with two lab technicians. The tall medical examiner beamed when he spotted Louise.
"Well, I'll be. I guess we haven't seen the last of you after all," he said, hugging her. "I was worried that it was me you were trying to get away from when you suddenly changed departments."
"You really didn't think that," she retorted, smiling and shaking her head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.